The Waspener Papers. A Journey Through the Multiverse. The First Level of Learning. Waspener.com. Genesis Section. Genesis Paper Number 1, Human Origins and the Living Library. By Waspener, Thursday, March 31, 2011. Waspener.com. 1. Abstract. This is certainly not an easy subject to research. There is tons of information out there, and because of its importance, there is also a lot of disinformation. I have gone through the sources I found coherent and in tune with my own feeling on the subject, and I've done my best to write a version which makes the most sense to me, and perhaps to the reader as well. When we are researching the old galactic wars and conflicts between species, we need to try to figure out the agenda of the source. For example, if we would interview an American soldier who comes back from the Iraq War, proud of his efforts, and then interview an Iraqi resistance man who is against the U.S. invasion, about the same event, we would get two entirely different stories. If we then interview a neutral Norwegian reporter, who was present in Iraq as well, we would get a third story. We have the same problem when trying to sort out the different channeled material we have at our convenience, and even the old clay and stone tablets were written by somebody, and we don't know how biased these somebodies were. Sometimes we can verify some of it by comparing it with other scriptures from around the world, which seem to be unrelated to each other but still tell a similar story. Yet, our galactic history is always a work in progress and may change as new information can be looked at and evaluated. Another problem we face is that time is perceived differently depending on where in the multiverse we are. Here on Earth we have our ways of counting time, while others calculate it in other terms. Sometimes, the channeled entities are doing their best to adjust to our way of thinking, but it's not always going to be accurate. Thus, depending on whom we ask, we may get a different time frame as of when a certain event happened. A metaphysical source which was notorious for this was the Ra Collective, the Ra Material, the Law of One. They admitted to that they had big problems translating our Earth time to their concept of universal time. If we also add to this different timelines, which are based on different realities, it becomes even more complex. We can only do our best to work with what we have and make sense out of it. Hence, it is always a work in progress, which is perfectly fine. To a large extent, I have used Lissa Royal and Keith Priest as sources to this lighter version of the galactic history. This is because their information tie neatly into what I am going to expand greatly upon in the second level of learning. Lissa Royal is an internationally known channel and author. Germain considers himself to be a non-physical group consciousness associated with the Orion Light, a future integrated version of the galactic family of which we on Earth are a part. He chose the name Germain because of its English definition, coming from the same source, or significantly relevant to. There is no connection to Saint Germain. A similar thing can be said about Jane Roberts' The Seth Material. The channeled entity Seth has nothing to do with the mythological Seth. It seems like Germain may be a faction of the Greys, and therefore many people have discarded Royal/Priest's very informative piece of work as disinformation. I don't. I consider her being just as valid as any of the other high-quality channels. It is sad that just because the entities who speak may be of a species that has a bad reputation because of what some of them are doing, we humans, as so often is the case, throw out the baby. I apologize if I use this phrase a lot in these papers, but it explains it so well. Manuel Lemiroy, whom I also use to some degree, is the founder and on the advisory board of the Exopolitics Institute of South Africa, www.exopoliticsinstitute.org weblink, manuel.secmeth.com weblink. He is also a regression therapist as well as a researcher into exopolitics and metaphysics. Hence, we can use his case studies to determine what is more likely to have happened in our distant past. He also seems to be in agreement with much of what Royal and Priest are saying. A third source is Dr. A.R. Borden because of his scientific perspective on the metaphysical tantrums. Other sources than these three, when they are used, will be footnoted. A fourth source is the Pleiadians, channeled by Barbara Marciniak. 2. Panspermia life in the universe is seeded by creator gods. We are actually going to start with Dr. Borden. He is suggesting that life, instead of starting out as a natural evolutionary process on a planet, instead is seeded by cosmic beings. In his essay, The Link, which can be downloaded from this website, he brings up this subject quite substantially. Still, he is certainly not the only modern scientist who has started to realize that this is the case. Fred Hoyle, in his time, and some before him, already touched on this. In metaphysics, this is a widespread and most common subject. Dr. Borden suggests there is evidence that life in its higher forms is seeded from outside and that they depend on genetic programs which come from space. He agrees with Brig Klyce, who says, it is a wholly scientific, testable theory for which evidence is accumulating, on his website, panspermia.org, Introduction, More Than Panspermia. In the footnote to his The Link, Dr. Borden says, the bold emphases are mine. Aside from that, the following excerpt is quoted directly from the original. Panspermia is an idea with ancient roots, according to which life arrives, ready-made, on the surface of planets from space. It is often said that panspermia isn't very interesting, because it simply removes the problem of the origin of life from our planet to some other place. And yet, panspermia has gained the attention of our science. There is now pseudopanspermia, the delivery of complex organic compounds from space, to give the prebiotic soup some starter ingredients, a notion has already becoming widely accepted. Basic panspermia, which holds that microbial life is present in space or on bodies like comets or asteroids, and it can be safely delivered to planets and start life there. If the cells escape from a living planet on fragments after a meteor impact, the phenomenon is called litho, ballistic, impact or meteoritic panspermia. And that's not all. Svante Arrhenius proposed that naked cells might travel interstellar distances propelled by light pressure, a theory now called radio panspermia. Whereas a light coating of carbon could protect single cells from UV radiation, a couple of meters of water or rock are needed for protection from cosmic rays. Consequently, radio panspermia is currently in disfavor. The danger of radiation damage influenced Francis Crick and Leslie Orgel, in 1973, to propose that life came to Earth by directed panspermia, the theory that intelligent life from elsewhere sent germs here in a spaceship. Modern panspermia proposes comets as the delivery vehicles. Comets can protect cells from UV and cosmic radiation damage, and comets can drop cells high in the atmosphere to float gently down. If bacterial spores can be immortal, as it appears, comets could spread life throughout a galaxy. Hoyle and Wickramasinghe, starting in the 1970s, rekindled interest in panspermia. But they went further to include a new understanding of evolution. While accepting the fact that life on Earth evolved over the course of about 4 billion years, they say that the genetic programs for higher evolution cannot be explained by a random mutation and recombination among genes for single-celled organisms. Even in that long a time, the programs must come from somewhere beyond Earth. In a nutshell, their theory holds that all of life comes from space. It incorporates the original panspermia in the same way that general relativity incorporates special relativity. Their expanded theory can well be termed strong panspermia. Their cosmic ancestry is a new theory pertaining to evolution and the origin of life on Earth. It holds that life on Earth was seeded from space, and that life's evolution to higher forms depends on genetic programs that come from space. It is a wholly scientific, testable theory for which evidence is accumulating. The above is the basis for understanding how life of higher intelligence starts on a planet. When comes to Earth, the human ancestors, all the way to modern Homo sapiens, the thinking man, were seeded by extraterrestrial beings in their image. Earth was originally created as a living library, and almost, if not everything growing and living on this planet originates from elsewhere in the universe and was brought here by different creator gods. This was revealed by the Pleiadians already in 1988-89. In addition, the species who developed here over time were then genetically manipulated by the same creator gods for different reasons. Many of them had their own agendas. There are even indicators that humankind was seeded more than once, something we will bring up in the second level of learning. 3. The creation of the solar system. What many people may not know is that the latest research says that the Milky Way galaxy, of which the Sun and the solar system are parts, is nearly as old as the universe itself. By today's measure, our current cycle of the universe, yes, there have been previous ones, is 13.7 billion years old, and our galaxy was formed just shortly thereafter, around 13.6 billion years ago. Our Sun and solar system were then created around 4.6 billion years ago. This said just to put creation in some perspective, and to think about that we humans, as Homo sapiens sapiens, have only existed for about 400,000 years, as we shall see in another paper, shows we are a pretty young species. However, we actually existed before that, but with another genetic setup. In the original solar system there was no Earth. Instead, in an orbit between Mars and Jupiter, there was a planet much bigger than Earth, orbiting the Sun. In mythology and literature, this planet goes under many names, where Maldek, Marduk, and Tiamat are only three. Zakaria Sitchin, the Russian linguist and author, who translated the Sumerian tablets and wrote the Earth Chronicles series about the Anunnaki, an alien race who came down to Earth some 450,000 years ago and later on created the current Homo sapiens sapiens, us, which we shall discuss at length in a few papers on this website, says that Tiamat was destroyed about 4.5 billion years ago, shortly after the solar system was created. In the raw material, however, where Tiamat is called Maldek, it states that this planet was inhabited by intelligent beings who even had built an Atlantis-like civilization before it was destroyed about 500,000 years ago. This corresponds pretty well with the Hopi, Apache Indian Robert Morning Sky's research which resulted in the Terra papers. What Morning Sky, Sitchin and Ra have in common is that Tiamat, Maldek was the planet between Mars and Jupiter which was destroyed. According to Sitchin, it was destroyed because an outside celestial body hit it and split it in half, while Ra and Morning Sky say it was destroyed by warfare. The Pleiadians tend to agree with Ra in this matter. The fact that the Ra Collective and Morning Sky say Maldek was inhabited directly contradicts Sitchin's translations. There may be a reason for this, given more credit to the Ra material, as Sitchin's translations, albeit quite accurate, are based on a rewrite of history, done by the same Anunnaki the tablets are describing. That this has occurred is known, but not to what extent. It could, however, explain the discrepancies between the two sources. For our purpose, on this level of learning, it doesn't matter who is correct, as it would inflict minimally, if at all, on what I intend to cover in this paper. 3.1 A violent visit from Sirius. The star Sirius is a trinary system, which means it consists of three stars in orbit around each other. Our scientists call them Sirius A, B, and C. This system is located about 8.6 light years from Earth, and Sirius A, which is its brightest components, also called the pole star, can be seen from Earth with the naked eye, being the brightest star in the night sky. The Sirius system is inhabited by many different races who migrated to there from other parts of our galactic sector, some of them hybrids from have been genetically engineered or had their DNA altered by creator gods. Sirius C was once orbited by a planet, which by its inhabitants called Sa.A.Me, pronounced Shemi, a body approximately six times bigger than Earth. In the Sumerian scriptures the planet is called Nibiru, or Ni.Bi.Ru. A little less than 1 billion years ago, Sirius C became a nova, exploded and ended up as a white dwarf star. However, 3.5 billion years before that, due to the instabilities of the original star, Nibiru was thrown out of its orbit and catapulted out in deep space, unmoored from its former orbit around Sirius C. The inhabitants had to leave the surface of the planet and live underground, and because Nibiru had, and still has, a lot of heat coming up from inside the planet, life can exist on it even today, and it does. It appears that these days they also have a city on the only remaining continent on the planet's surface. After having traveled through space for a very long time, Nibiru was allegedly drawn into our solar system by the gravity of our outer planets and came in on retrograde. On its eccentric orbit and journey through our young solar system, one of its many moons, according to Sitchin, hit Tiamat and split the planet in half. After this violent visit, Nibiru left the inner solar system and continued its journey out in deep space again. However, due to the gravity from our solar system, Nibiru was now once and for all caught up by it and from there on became a part of it. It started revolving around our Sun in a vast, elliptic orbit which takes around 3,600 years, give or take. One orbit around our Sun is called a Sar, pronounced Sher, like Enshi, by its inhabitants. So, one Sar later, the story goes, Nibiru came back, and one of the two halves of Tiamat was hit again and became what we know today as the asteroid belt. The second half, again struck by one of Nibiru's moons, was thrown out of orbit and became Earth. Another thing covered by the old Sumerians is that our moon was basically one of Nibiru's moons, which they dropped during one of its crossings, and this is probably the reason why researchers like David say that the moon is inhabited by reptilian beings, while others say that we were interrupted in our Apollo program because whomever claimed ownership of the moon didn't want us there. What happened to the rest of the solar system when Nibiru entered the first couple of times is quite extensively covered in the Sumerian creation epic, Enuma Elish, and nicely summarized by Dr. Lesson in his Enki Speaks papers, www.bibliotkapoliads.net web link. I will not cover it in any more details here in this paper, as it is out of the scope of our story, so feel free to click on the above link to read up on that part. 4. The First Creator Gods. By now we understand from have studied different metaphysical material that universes are created with certain goals in mind, and when the goals are achieved, they stop expanding and return to first source, the prime creator. It appears that when this happens, the souls inhabiting the particular universe can choose whether they want to re-merge with Source, from where we all stem, or go for another ride through a new universe, recycled from the old one, and now with a new goal in mind. Some say this universe is on its fourth cycle. First Source can also be described as the void, as mentioned in my earlier papers on this website. As mentioned in the beginning of this paper, our Milky Way galaxy is very old, estimated to have been created around 13.6 billion years ago. Lisa Royal and Keith Priest, in their The Prism of Lyra, An Exploration of Human Galactic Heritage, the authors are suggesting that this whole universe was created within the time-space fabric of the Lyran's constellation in form of a white hole, which they liken to a prism. Dr. Arthur David Horn and his wife, Lynette Ann Mallory Horn, paraphrase Royal and Priest in their book, Humanity's Extraterrestrial Origins, E.T. Influences on Humankind's Biological and Cultural Evolution, Silbersner 1994, 1996, 1997. As a portion of the whole passed through this prism, several frequencies were created. Consciousness fragmented away from other segmented consciousness. Apparently the purpose of this experience is to first experience aspects of separateness, then bring back what is learned and experienced and then reintegrate into the whole. In addition to consciousness, the three-dimensional, third density, universe was also created. The planets, stars, gases, and atoms that make up the physical universe. This third density reality represents only a small part of the energy frequencies that emerged from the segmentation of the whole. Another thing they tell us, which correlates with my own findings, is their mentioning of the founders. These correspond quite neatly with what the Lyricus teaching order, part of the Wingmaker's material, is telling us about the tribes of light and the central race. Royal Priest are letting us know that the Founders were created around the same time as the universe itself to initially seed it and make sure things were developing as intended by Source. Supposedly, the Founders are always there in the beginning of a universe cycle to work directly with First Source. Royal Priest call them the supervisors of the creation of this galaxy, with full memory of the blueprints of the creation from the whole. They segmented themselves to create a parent individualized consciousness, which could go out and create, as the Pleiadians put it in Merciniak's channeled book, Bringers of the Dawn. Royal Priest, as well as the Pleiadians, depict at least some of the Founders as 1060 feet tall praying mantises when they are in their physical, not to be confused with the not-so-tall praying mantises whom abductees report they have seen working together with the Greys and the Reptilians during traumatic abductions. We have previously touched the subject that planets, stars and galaxies are sentient beings and also collective oversouls in an ascending hierarchy. I find this to be very plausible, and Royal Priest goes so far as to say that these oversouls are all Founders, and fragments thereof, whom have segmented themselves into stars and planets, and perhaps also the souls of human beings living in the third density Earth. They did so to have an as full experience as possible in this universe. If you look up in the night sky next time and see all the myriads of stars, don't be surprised if what you see is one expression of the Founders. You can communicate directly with them by sending your energy up there, or even direct it to a certain star or star system, and they will know who you are. Another theory, which is just as widespread, is that when a star race, such as us, evolve, we eventually become creator gods ourselves and evolve to become stars, overseeing our own planet systems, and from there we become a galactic consciousness and so on. Where evolution ends, we can't even guess. The purpose with our particular galaxy was apparently set already from the start, or between the collapse of the earlier version of the universe and our current one, all of it, we may assume, orchestrated on a higher level by First Source itself. According to the Pleiadians in the same book as mentioned in the previous section, the purpose of the Milky Way galaxy is for its inhabitants to have free will, where anything goes, as a great experiment, to see what happens. It appears that each galaxy in a particular universe has its own goals to achieve, and they don't necessarily correspond with the goals of the Milky Way. The Pleiadians, and also the Orions, apparently, go so far as to say that the universe, and God in itself, is feminine in nature and not neuter or masculine as most of us have learned. They claim that the divine feminine was turned into the divine masculine by the patriarchal regime hundreds of thousands of years ago when the Anunnaki landed on Earth and took over the old living library in progress and destroyed it. The gender change was important for them to be able to suppress the truth and insert their own false religion on mankind. I may most possibly touch this subject in more details in the second level of learning. This level will take on the research of Sitchin and how that correlates with that of LPGC, but I have already found a lot of discrepancies in Sitchin's books, but most of it will not be addressed until on the next level of learning. People need to get familiar with Sitchin's work to be able to understand what is currently going on in present time and how it relates to end time prophecies. The follow-up on this on the next level of learning may shock some people. 5. The Galactic Wars, are human ancestry, and genetic engineering. Billions of years ago, the Founders started creating bodies which would be sufficient for intelligent life in the third dimension for the segmented parts of themselves, souls, information clouds, to inhabit. This is how the first life forms were created, and among them, humanoids were made out of a predetermined template, two arms, two legs, a torso, and a head. The reason most comes in two is to symbolize the duality, polarity of this physical universe. These first humanoids were created and evolved in the Laran system and spread from there throughout the galaxy. However, there were other kinds of beings, who crossed over from the previous universe cycles, which are not humanoid. The Dracos appear to be one of these species, and some hyperversals may be as well. The first humanoid species the Founders created started off in the constellation of Lyra. They were very human-like, but much taller. They eventually developed into a space-faring race with the intention to explore the universe and conquer new worlds. In the meantime, the Founders created other humanoid species elsewhere, and with time, many of these came upon each other as they started visiting and conquer each other's star systems. Wars and conflicts were certainly not unusual. It was part of experiencing the free will universe where everything goes, but where karma is helping you grow. The Founders were totally fine with that. The early humanoids conquered space and had their wars. They understood that this was a phase they had to go through before they learned. Another species, also from the Lyran star system, was the Vegans, originating from a previous density version of the star Vega, quite close to Earth. Not much is left of this race today in their original form, but they played a major role in seeding and building genetics and DNA on Earth. In fact, they were the pioneers. Where the Founders left off, other creator gods took their place and started seeding planets across the Milky Way, using their own human template as a base, mixing their DNA with other species which were already there, after had been created in the first seeding by the Founders. These already existing species were often of the lower density animal and plant kingdoms. Each planet in the Milky Way which is inhabited by intelligent mammals has its own version of humanoids, slightly different in height, color, and features in general. Some are giants, some are short, some are sturdy while others are thin, etc. Still, intelligent 3D life forms are all based on the human template. However, here is some modification to that fact. Due to that some beings, like the Dracos, transferred over from a previous cycle, they too have seeded our galaxy, hence there are other life forms as well. Reptilian beings, to a certain extent, surprisingly enough, seem to have originated on Earth, though, when the Vegans mixed their own DNA with that of the dinosaurs. The Vegans continued their genetic experiments by working directly with the dinosaurs to create an intelligent race consisting of mainly reptilian beings. They succeeded, although they were technically still mammals, appearing reptilian-like. Much of this genetic tinkering was not done on Earth, however. The Vegans often landed here in what they must have considered quite a hostile environment with all those giant dinosaurs roaming around. Instead, they colonized Mars and Moldek, where they did much of the genetic engineering. Mars at that point had atmosphere, with forest, oceans, lakes, rivers, etc., just like Earth, and the Vegan were oxygen breathers. So now we have three main intelligent species: the humanoid, the Vegan, reptilian hybrids, and the reptilians. I believe some of the reptilians and other species whom we have encountered, and are not fitting in with the Milky Way template, came here from other galaxies. This is also what LPGC hash indicate, and there are others as well. Most reptilians that were created by the Vegans took off to other parts of the galaxy, more precisely Orion and Lyra. They didn't stay long in the Earth vicinity, but I believe there were a few who did. They became what we now call the Reptoids, who live inside Earth and are sometimes spotted by people close to caverns and mountains. This species is, as told by those who have encountered them, quite friendly in nature, but consider Earth being theirs, due to that they were here before humans. The Vegans were a dark-skinned race, with dark, often brownish hair, very tall in stature. They were quite telepathic, had great physical strength, but were generally quite friendly and spiritual, although they went through different phases like all other species, and they were of course all different individuals with different personalities. We can compare them, if only vaguely, with today's Native American, Asian and Aboriginal people. Royal and Priest compare them to the Vulcans as well in the Star Trek series. Their main purpose was to explore how to use DNA to create different species, and they were very careful not to act as violent or abusive. When they first landed on Earth during the dinosaur era, they claimed Earth as their real estate, as the customs often are in the free will universe. 5.1 Evidence of giants on Earth. Some of the creator gods were indeed giants, up to 35-36 feet high, www.stevegle.com weblink, overmanwarrior.wordpress.com weblink, and when they used their DNA in experiments, their offspring became giants as well. Merchaniak Channeling the Pleiadians, Lectures, Fall 2010, CD number 8, tracks 4 and 6. Skeletons of giants have been found all over the world by archaeologists, but mostly, these discoveries have been laughed off as hoaxes. Some of them are, of course, because as soon as the truth is published, someone who is paid for it comes out and discredits it, but many of these findings, discarded as hoaxes or not, are quite interesting, because they show how some of these beings looked like. The researcher, Steve Quayle, has spent a lot of time finding pictures of giant skeletons and posted them on his website, www.stevegle.com. Some of these giants had six fingers and six toes and a double set of teeth. This 9-foot giant was found in a grave in Utah. Still, this guy is considered a dwarf in comparison to the ones of real stature. Look at the skull, in particular. 5.2 The Vegan, Liren War. The spiritual traits of the vegans became subject to jealousy from another humanoid race, the Lirens. They looked very Caucasian and can up to this day only be separated from a typical white, Caucasian person by their stature, and some of them have pointed ears, like Tolkien's elves. They were not as physically strong as the vegans, but had more aggressive genes. They came to Earth with a purpose to conquer. A war broke out between the vegans and the Lirens, which the Lirens won. The vegans had to leave Earth, Mars and Moldak to the Lirens and give up their real estate. So, they went to Sirius and Orion, where they colonized quite a few planetary systems, before they settled down and went back to a more spiritual path. According to Royal, priest in the Prism of Lyra, much of the vegan mysticism is the origin of many spiritual teachings on Earth, like those of the Tibetan culture before Buddhism, and the Vedic culture in India, prior to Hinduism. Very few ancient texts exist on Earth from this highly influential time period. Here we need to back up a little bit and introduce another species on stage, the infamous Drakens. They were of pure reptilian blood, but related neither to the Lirens, nor the vegans. No one knows exactly where they came from. Some say they originate from another universe, while others say they came from this one, but entered here from one of the many stargates or Einstein-Rosen bridges. They had scales, horns, a tail, but otherwise one head, two arms, two legs and a torso. Their necks were shielded just like on a triceratops, but had no horn growing from their foreheads. According to Ashiana Dean in her book Voyager's Eye, the Drakens came to Earth during the dinosaur era, just like the vegans, but not necessarily during the same time period. The dinosaur era lasted for almost 200 million years. Dean explains that the early dinosaurs were all vegetarians and quite docile in temperament until the Drakens started genetically tamper with them. This indicates that they were here before the vegans, who came at the end of the dinosaur era, when there were both meat-eaters and vegetarians amongst the big reptiles. After had tampered with the dinosaurs, they created Draken, dinosaur hybrids with the intelligence of the Draken species, and ended up with the prototype for the draconian reptiles, not of vegan stock. Some of these hybrids were left on Earth, fitting well into the climate and conditions of Earth at the time, when it was much warmer. Through these Draco hybrids, the Drakens could monitor the human evolution on Earth while the vegans created our first vegan, human ancestors. About 1 million years ago, the Drakens thought the human species on Earth had developed enough for them to be used in their own genetic engineering projects. The Draken ships arrived and started hovering over Earth. They landed and abducted human females and impregnated them with Draken seed during frequent visitations. Some of these impregnations were quite painful for the human females. However, the Draken, human interbreeding and genetic tinkering didn't work as planned, because the offspring could not live very long in the Earth's atmospheric conditions, and these hybrids were therefore taken back to Thuban, which was their home planet in the Alpha Draconis star system. The Draken, human hybrids became what we today call the Dracos. The Drakens also later on interbred with Illyrian/Syrian/Pleiadian Anunnaki, and this is why the Anunnaki during Sumerian times were depicted both as reptilians and humanoid. However, this is an extremely complicated matter, and will be discussed in the second level of learning and is not necessary to learn at this point. At this first level of learning, I am wanting to get a certain message through, and therefore it's important not to be too complicated, or we'll get lost in it. The more complex issues are best to be discussed at a later time. 5.3 The Draconian and Orion Wars. The Drakens and their hybrids have been involved in most of the galactic wars worth their names. The Drakens were a ruthless warrior race and had one group imperative in mind over all the rest, summarized in three words: explore, conquer and expand. The most intense wars raged in the Orion sector, in and around the Ring Nebula. To make a long and complicated story short, factions of the Vegans and Lyrans, when they encountered the Drakens and their hybrid warriors, came together in an alliance to defeat this very strong enemy. Both empires, the Lyran, Vegan and the Drakens, the latter whom had joined forces with other reptilian groups, had common interests in certain worlds that they wanted to conquer, and this started a full drawn-out war. The battles originated in the Orion Ring Nebula, but almost simultaneously, from another flank, the Dracos did a full-force attack upon the home planets of the Lyrans, destroyed many of them, and killed millions of Lyrans in the process. Fortunately, for them, most of the Lyrans had already migrated to other worlds. The migrated Lyrans were devastated at first, but then broke out in rage and wanted revenge. After the destruction of the Lyran planets, the war was concentrated to Orion. At that time, the Orion star systems were mainly inhabited by Lyrans, Vegans, and Reptilians. The Greys came into the picture later. When the Lyrans heard about the destruction of their home planets, they retaliated by furiously attacking Draken, Reptilian colonies in Orion and created much devastation there. However, the Draconian Reptilians were fast to respond. Also, around that time, some humanoids, mainly Vegans, had started cooperating with the Draken Alliance, simply because they had common interests in what they wanted to colonize and which part of space they wanted to explore. The Draken group had as a purpose to colonize and conquer the whole Sector 9 of the Milky Way galaxy, which is the sector which Earth belongs to, and they were well on their way. The alliance between the Reptilians and the Humanoids is still known as the Orion Empire, and is much more recent than the Draconian Empire, after the time when Vegans had started engaging themselves in space travel. It is my understanding that the Dracos and other reptilian races from Orion are still the majority of the reptilians in that part of Sector 9, but there are no longer any open wars, although tension exists between the races. They even trade these days, but small battles still occur. Long before the Lyrans got involved in the war against the Dracos, the latter had conquered a lot of worlds where the original inhabitants had to obey to the Draconian Emperor. There was a lot of discontent amongst these populations, and many of them now saw their chance and hooked up with the Lyrans, against their oppressors. This new alliance resulted in a federation of planets, and they all stood united against the Draconian Empire. This federation still exists and is one of the main players in Sector 9. The members are civilizations from the Lyra constellation, the Andromeda constellation, the Pleiades, the Hyades open clusters, Emma, Wolf 424, Procyon, Tau Ceti, Alpha Centauri, and Epsilon Eridani, all being of Lyran, Pleiadian heritage. More about the Pleiadian her. In addition, there were a number of non-physical massless hyperversal races joining, but also some Syrian groups and some Orion groups as well. Others were of various civilizations from parallel universes such as the Caldasians, and the Dal. Eventually, they even got some company from renegade reptilians, who wanted to free themselves from the tyranny of the Dracos. As time went by, the nature of the wars changed. They started out with a purpose to expand territory and explore new worlds, but after many years it became more about ideologies. There were quite a few humanoid forces who had joined the Federation of Planets because they were tired of being victimized by the Dracos. Gradually, they started living under the Law of One, understanding that it is important to support both oneself and others around you to be able to expand, not only physically by conquering other worlds, but also to expand spiritually. Up until then, all sides, with a few exceptions, had the philosophy that service to self, STS-, was okay, because they were aware of that we are all one, and if they were STS-, they helped others by helping themselves. That would work, as long as STS included others, but the wars showed that the philosophy had been warped on the way. STS now meant service to self at the expense of others, and that was something entirely different. This was the cause to victimization and victimhood. With karma also being included in the mix, things got pretty serious. Those who felt they were victims started looking at those who had conquered them as evil and themselves as good. Thus, polarization now became a very unbalanced factor in these wars. This, of course, for somebody who doesn't believe war is the answer to anything, is self-explanatory, as war is always STS to the extreme. However, in the philosophy of many ancient races, this was looked upon differently. These warrior species still had to learn how karma works in a free will universe, which at the time was quite young. Now, in summary, on one side we had the Federation of Planets, whose members more and more started thinking in terms of service to others, STO-, understanding that supporting and helping both self and others is important, as both are parts of the same whole. On the other side we had the Draconian Empire, which now merged with the Orion Empire because they felt they had common interests, which led to joined forces. This empire, which exists up to this day as the Orion, Draconian Empire, side by side with the Federation of Planets, stayed overly STS with the serve self at the expense of others attitude. So the wars dragged on and on for eons. 5.4 The Pleiadians, immigrants from a previous universe. One of the most popular channeled entities on Earth today is the Pleiadians, channeled by Barbara Marciniak. This renegade group of different beings from different star systems has come from our future to meet us here during the nanosecond, 1987 to 2012, and beyond. They are telling us that they are here to change their present, our future, by changing the events on their timeline. In other words, by changing their present, they are here in order to be able to change their past so that they can heal along the lines of time and take care of their karma. They say they live in a very tyrannical and oppressive time in the future Pleiades, with heavy-duty machine technology and with a tight control system on top of that. A few renegade Pleiadians in our future, a resistance group of sorts, figured out that the reason they are in this nightmare environment is because of decisions that we humans made during the nanosecond, all in accordance to their own direct timeline. They could see that this was their collective karma that they now have to face and handle. The way to do this, they figure, is to contact us in the nanosecond and inform us about the choices we have, and that we don't need to eventually live in the future they are now experiencing if we make more conscious choices than we did on their timeline, which goes back to old Atlantis and beyond. If we look around us today, we are quickly heading towards a machine kingdom, with tons of electronic devices which totally absorb our children's lives, and adults too for that matter, and everything is becoming computerized. Cloning, artificial intelligence and nanotechnology are getting huge funding by the powers that be, and we are totally caught up in a life of stress, multitasking, financial meltdowns, heart attacks and other illnesses. The medical field is getting sponsored to develop techniques to implant new organs safely in bodies that are failing, and technologies are getting developed, this is partly alien technology, to insert machine parts instead of real organs, which work as well as the real ones. In the near future, we will be half human and half machine, and implants, digital and biological, will also be inserted in humans for us to be able to buy and sell, and these implants will help the powers that be, PTB-, to control our thoughts and behavior. This is exactly the path the Pleiadians chose in the past, which led up to the reality they now have to live in. So a few of these renegades left their body in our future and met in a safe place from where they contacted Barbara Marciniak, mind to mind, in 1988, and she agreed to be their vehicle for channeling. This future Pleiadian group wants to alert us on that we have a chance in 26,000 years, more about this later, to tune into the galactic boost of energy that is occurring now, in our nanosecond. If enough humans on this planet manage to activate our dormant DNA by receiving encoded information carried on gamma rays from the Sun and the galactic center, we will be able to transform to a new Earth and thus bypass the machine kingdom that is planned by the PTB hash. The majority of the population will not be able to consciously tune into this energy and thus will not raise their vibration enough to transform into a higher frequency. But as long as at least a certain number of people will be able to raise their frequency, a new world, based on these new common morals and ethics codes, will be transformed from our new mass consciousness. Our planet will metaphysically split into two Earths. This is what the Pleiadians hope we will achieve, because if we do, that will change their timeline. They can tune into this new one, hopefully, they say, and that will change their present. The worst thing that can happen is that they and their reality will be erased if we succeed, but if that happens, they accept it, they will still live on as spiritual beings, and it's better to be free spirits than trapped in machine technology that's gone overboard. However, they are quick to add that there is nothing wrong with technology in itself, it's how it's being used. So this is their agenda, and they are totally open with it. There is much more to this, which I will go into at a later time, but this is the short version. If we succeed, and they say we probably will, in one way or the other, it will gain both them and us, so it's a win-win situation. As the channeling through Marciniak continued with success, more and more renegades, not only from the Pleiadian star systems but from elsewhere too, joined in, and the group rapidly grew in numbers during the 1990s up to this date. It is today a mix of the original small group, probably humanoid, and reptilian renegades, perhaps from Orion. When I listen to their CDs, I believe I can distinguish between the channelers as of whom is reptilian and who is humanoid, by their voices, energies, and temperaments. So let us see how these Pleiadians fit into our past ancestry, because they say they in certain terms are us in the future. In Marciniak's excellent book, Bringers of the Dawn, which is a channeled book, the Pleiadians say they came to this universe from a previous universe, which had completed its cycle Lyotage soon. The completion of their old universe was fulfilled once the life force within it, in unison, realized that they were all one with Source and they were all creator gods. They had the choice to go back and merge with Source, or continue exploring reality in a new universe. They chose the latter. In the book, they continue by telling us that not only do they come from our future, they are us in the future. But they are also our ancestors, who were some of the original planners of Earth, meaning the original creator gods, who seeded humans on Earth. Over the years, the Pleiadians have mainly depicted themselves the way they looked like in their ancient past, being tall, Caucasian-looking. They have also given hints toward the blue beings and the Nordics. In other words, they looked pretty much like Caucasian Scandinavians of today, but taller in stature. This compares very well with the Lyrans. Especially, as we shall see when our story unfolds, that there apparently were a Scandinavian faction of the Lyrans, according to Royal, Priest, who later migrated to the Pleiades. The original Pleiadian group we hear from today are mostly from Electra and Maia. The puzzle pieces fit. So, the Pleiadians are simply a faction of the original Lyrans, who were the prototype that the Founders used to populate this sector of the universe. As time went by, the Vegans first, the Lyrans later, came to Earth and started building what was to become the Living Library, a planet which could hold the DNA and the knowledge of the entire galaxy, not only in pure thought form but also as manifestation in force-space/time. Therefore, mankind is an experiment, and as such, closely monitored by many different off-planetary beings. The intention was good and the project started, as we shall see, but was interrupted by forces who seemed to have other intentions which were not so noble, and the project came to a halt. But more about this later. 5.5 The Vegan Entrapment. Going back to our story, when the vegans had been defeated by the Lyrans, the vegans migrated to Orion, became more and more associated with this star group, and they began to call themselves the Orions, more or less forgetting about their vegan heritage. They, in conjunction with the reptilian Orion queens, became the notorious and feared Orions. The vegans even created a frequency net that trapped everybody who lived in Orion and were of vegan humanoid descent in a frequency prison. Even after death, they were trapped in the Orion matrix and had no choice but to reincarnate into the Orion system. This was the ultimate control system, and those in charge gained a lot of power, because they knew that they had the Orion souls trapped. Beings from outside, who were ignorant about what the frequency net did, with a little smarts, could enter the Orion system from outside, but once inside, they couldn't get out. So it was a closed system. Thus, the reptilians and other races who were aware of this frequency fence had a tendency to avoid the star systems controlled by the vegan Orions. Even the Drakens did. As always, when there is big oppression within a civilization, there is resistance, and so also here. They were called the Black League, black as in hidden, and it took them many lifetimes of resistance, living in caves underground, often on hot desert planets, away from civilization, to get this oppression resolved. However, like so many before them, they thought they could meet violence with violence, so they started civil wars against their huge government. This, of course, was a war that could not be won, and eventually the resistance had to flee, fragmented and defeated. The few who survived had to go well into hiding, and it took long before the Black League could get reorganized again. According to Royal Priest, there were some priests who figured out how to raise their vibrations and escape the frequency field. When they had trained themselves spiritually to do this, they looked for a target to escape to, and that target was Earth, the planet that once had been so dear to the vegans. The priests managed to escape and appeared here on Earth, mainly during the Lemurian and Atlantis eras, two very important periods in the history of Earth, which we will not discuss in any deeper details until the second level of learning, because the subject of the Atlantis, Lemurian cultures is rather complex if we want to cover it to any extent, and I need to organize my research material and make some complementary research as well on this before I can post anything substantial. It's much more to it than most people realize. In the meantime, while the Orion vegans fought their own internal battle, galactic wars of great proportion continued to rage in Sector 9. 5.6 The continuing story of the living library and major genetic engineering on Earth. In Darwinism, we are taught that life develops in sequence in a long evolutionary line, one thing leads to another, and the strongest species and their members survive and the rest get extinct, to put it very simply, but there are lots of holes in Darwin's theories which we don't have time to go into here. However, for those who are interested, please read the first two chapters of Dr. Arthur David Horn and Lynette Ann Mallory Horn, 1997, Humanity's Extraterrestrial Origins, ET Influences on Humankind's Biological and Cultural Evolution, and it will be quite clear. Dr. Horn was himself a Darwinist and anthropologist before he realized that Darwin's theories simply don't hold water, and instead he began to research the ET involvement in the evolution of planet Earth, as this was the only thing that made sense, he concluded. I am totally agreeing with Dr. Horn in this respect, and with the evidence available regarding the weaknesses in Darwinism. We are going to stick with the much more plausible history of planet Earth, which highly involves beings from outer space. Horn and Mallory Horn bring up another interesting point in their book. They say that what they call the Cambrian explosion, where marine life with hard skeletal parts suddenly appeared 570 million years ago, that this would seem to be a clear example of genetic manipulation by some ET inception group. They continue. Not only did animals with hard body parts appear suddenly at the beginning of the Cambrian period, but also all of the basic body planes, or phyla, of all the types of animals that have existed on Earth appeared simultaneously at this time. Based on the fossil record, the Mesopotamian historical records of ET genetic manipulation of an Earth life form, humans, the Dognoral history of ET visitation, plus the esoteric information provided in the Prism of Lyra, the ET, Lyran, Inception group must have laid the foundation of the development and evolution of all animal life on Earth during the Cambrian explosion, and 100 million years before that. This scenario would explain why no new phyla, or basic body plans, have appeared since the Cambrian period. Dr. Arthur David Horn and Lynette Ann Mallory Horn, 1997, Humanity's Extraterrestrial Origins, ET Influences on Humankind's Biological and Cultural Evolution, pages 72. This is true, and directly contradicts Darwin's theory on evolution of the species. It looks like the early creator gods were busy here during the Mesozoic era, which was the era of the dinosaurs, 254 to 66.4 million years ago. During this period, small mammals were also seeded. According to the Pleiadians, the dinosaurs were acting as guardians of the planet, so the experiment with the living library could continue with as little interruption as possible at times when the creator gods were not here. They also mention that there was a time, I would assume by the end of the dinosaur era, when human-like creatures walked the Earth together with the dinosaurs. This corresponds with the vegan, Lyran visitations as discussed above. Then, a big mystery hit the Earth, the dinosaurs became extinct. This has puzzled the scientists since the time they found the first skeletons. What killed them? Was it a drastic climate change? Did a huge comet hit Earth? Why did the reptiles die out and the mammals lived on and started flourishing after that? According to a Pleiadian lecture I listened to, the big reptiles were intentionally gotten rid of because they were no longer needed, and they also were too dangerous to have around if the gods wanted to continue the seeding of Earth. Exactly how they were extinct is still something I can't answer with certainty, but it sounds like the gods took care of it. Another theory, which fits more with mainstream scientific theories, is that Earth was hit by a huge comet, which created a climate change and perhaps a pole shift, and that took care of the extinction. This huge comet may have been the passing to nearby Earth through our solar system. A piece of one of its many moons may have struck the Earth and created the catastrophe. Let us now go back to the story when the Lyran took over from the vegans and started spreading out on the planets of our solar system. It was still at the final end of the dinosaur era, so we're talking 65-70 million years ago. The Lyrans now started their genetic manipulation program big time, something which eventually ended with the end of the dinosaurs and the creation of primates on Earth. They thought that these beings could eventually be most compatible with their own consciousness. These settlers of Lyran humanoids, once being a dreaded warrior race, now becoming their own creator gods, changed their mindsets quite a bit and they had a leap in their consciousness and awareness. With time, both they and the vegans, Lyrans faster than the vegans, tended to forget their origins the more time they spent in this physical universe of free will, and therefore, they also forgot who they were before they came into this universe from a previous one, and what their real goal was. With time, some of these memories came back to them, and they realized that the goal of this universe is to experience how it is to live in a reality where everything goes, and then take this experience back to Source, after which they again can decide whether they want to stay with Source or continue for yet another cycle. By realizing this, everything changed. They no longer felt the urge to violently conquer space or invade other species and claim their real estate, planetary body. Rather, they now wanted to concentrate on building this living library with their own divine DNA mixed with a genetically manipulated version of themselves, containing all the memories of this universe from beginning to end, all encoded into the DNA of this new species. The memory could be fairly easily encoded by using their own multidimensional 12-strand DNA as a base. The idea was then to have species from elsewhere in the universe donate their DNA to the experiment to have a wider range of experiences connected to the human body. They were well aware of that DNA is not just a physical thing, but if you add DNA from another species to your own, you have an instant connection with the donator from there on, no matter where in the universe the original donor roams. This way, you would have a biological being whose body works as a living library in itself. By having its DNA fully activated, this species would have its nerve endings expand all over the cosmos. People could come visit Earth from all around and learn from this human species, similar to when you go to a physical library here on Earth. And not only that, the Lirans also wanted to import plants and animals from all over the universe and have their DNA set up in a certain way, as well as to enhance the living library so that it spans through all dimensions and densities. They also started similar experiments on a few other planets in this galaxy and beyond, but Earth is still quite rare and unique, and its beauty, as we all know, is stunning. Few places in the universe has such diversity. If you step back and look at it with new eyes, it may dawn to you how different all the animals and the plants are from each other. There is an almost endless variety of flora and fauna. Did this all happen by chance? No, almost all of it has been imported from all over the cosmos. Many worlds out there have a sparse variety of animal and plant life, and many planets are desert-like. There is just enough to have the ecological system going. In addition, most aliens don't eat meat, it's very gross to them, and neither do the animals. It's mostly on strictly third-density worlds, and especially those which are operating within a very narrow frequency, that life forms eat each other. Therefore, a wide variety is not necessarily needed. Also, on more planets than we can imagine, the life forms live inside the planet, not on the surface. So, why all this variety here on Earth? Well, although beauty has to do with it, it's just part of the reason. The plants, herbs and vegetables are our natural pharmacy. In the Middle Ages, and certainly in ancient times, people knew how to use the living library to boost their immune systems, cure diseases, and expand their reality. Marijuana, hemp, and hashish are just two examples on the mild end, and they are all there to be used. In moderation, I should add. Over time, this knowledge has been suppressed by the PTB hash big time to keep the population in line, to keep the sheep in the fold, so to speak. Even more so the last 100 years or so, when Big Pharma started making money on people's illnesses. They couldn't allow any competition from the living library, so they either outlawed certain plants, like marijuana, or simply suppressed the knowledge by ridiculing it. The Pleiadians, on the CD sets they release shortly after each equinox, have said that there is much more to the living library than they can go into right now for security reasons. We, humans, have security codes embedded in our DNA, which were put there by the original creator gods, in case someone would come and tamper with us in the future. This way, the intruders could not access the deepest secrets of the living library. As the Pleiadians put it on a recent CD, we humans are the library cards, and the intention was that when other beings came visiting from other parts of the universe to study the living library, they first had to come through us humans to sign up. The living library is like a school of learning, which has different layers to it. One can only access the layers which vibrate on one's frequency and match one's consciousness and awareness level. If someone is looking for something that isn't, they won't be given access to it for several different reasons. Two main reasons being, they wouldn't understand and appreciate it, or they may misuse or abuse it. As we can see, the Lirans put a lot of thought, work, and effort into this huge project. In our terms, this whole project took many, many millions of years, but the early creator gods, both Lirans and Vegans, had very long life spans. From our point of view, they seemed to live forever, and they didn't age, noticeably, and like the science fiction writer David Brin said, galactic beings think long thoughts. Plans that span thousands of years were not uncommon and not a problem for our ancestors. In the beginning, the Lyrans primarily lived on Mars and Maldek in the constructs that the Vegans had built before them, but they didn't like the climate and the atmosphere there as well as the Vegans did, so they decided to move down to Earth and do whatever they could to make it comfortable for them, as the Earth atmosphere was at least a little less uncomfortable for them than that of the two other planets. One group moved up to the area that is now Scandinavia, although the land masses of today do not totally correspond with the ones of ancient times. These Lyrans were the ones who felt the strongest connection with Earth and began to feel a great affinity for the planet they had settled on. They became very connected with nature and all the elements and developed a spiritual mindset. At first, by the time they settled down, they still contributed their DNA to the mix, but soon enough they became less and less interested in participating. Instead, they focused on making Earth their new home. The main genetic experimentation they were involved in was that of taking some Earth genetics and incorporate them into themselves. They still had some problems with adapting to the Earth atmosphere in regard to oxygen content, gravitation field, etc. It became hard for them to operate with their full potential, so they took a small amount of primate DNA and incorporated it into their successive generations. This way, they were eventually able to fully adapt to life on Earth. As time went by, their mentality began to change even more. They felt like they had become more at home here on Earth than on their home planet in the Lyra star system, and they started calling themselves Earth Lyrans, putting Earth in front of Lyra. "We are making big jumps in time here on occasion, because all of this happened over a long time period, in our terms." While the Earth Lyrans adapted to their new home on Earth, the galactic wars were still raging over their heads, and they found themselves no longer being the only species on Earth. Other ETs, some Lyrans and some Sirians and Orions, were here too at the same time as the Earth Lyrans. One of these alien races were the ones who inhabited Nibiru, the 10th planet, 12th planet in Sitchin's translations, which used to orbit Sirius C, but now was a member of our own solar system. Although Nibiru once orbited this particular star in the Sirius system, the Nibiruans, or the Sid.A.M.I, as they called themselves in their own language, some say were part Lyrans, humanoid, and part reptilian, Draco hybrids. However, there were other groups and subgroups here too at the same time, working in different parts of the world. The Sid.A.M.I started out in Sumer, modern Iraq, and the southern parts of Africa, where they also dug for gold and precious metals, some of it to enhance their own, declining Nibiruan atmosphere, but also for other reasons we may go into later. They became interested in creating a slave race for themselves rather than to help creating the living library, and they eventually got in great conflict with the original Lyrans, who were busy building the library. The Lyrans were very successful in building the library, and many different energies were brought into existence. Among others, very evolved civilizations emerged from their efforts. The dominant Lyran-human hybrid they had created was androgynous and multidimensional, and also had the Lyran 12-strand DNA activated. This civilization existed for a very long time, from our perspective, and was on its peak around 500,000 years ago. We are not talking about Atlantis or Lemuria, which are more modern than this civilization. If we want to go look for remnants of them today, we have to look under the ice caps of the far southern continent of Antarctica, and some can also be found in modern North Russia. Suddenly, a war broke out in space between the Sid.A.M.I. Later in the Sumerian scriptures called the Anunnaki, and the Lyrans. The Anunnaki creator gods raided the Earth around 300,000 years ago, while the human civilization in Antarctica and Russia were still in their fullest. This time period is considered the beginning of human civilization, but in fact, it was only the beginning of something new and the death of something older and much more benevolent and evolved. Eventually, after long and bitter battles over real estate Earth, the original planners lost the war. Darkness had defeated light and Earth became the territory of the Anunnaki. Some of these battles extended to Earth herself, developing into atomic wars. The Lyrans, defeated, were forced to leave the solar system. What happened next is explained by the Pleiadians as follows. They, the Anunnaki, the new owners, rearranged your DNA in order to have you broadcast within a certain limited frequency band whose frequency could feed them and keep them in power. The original human was a magnificent being whose 12 strands of DNA were contributed by a variety of sentient civilizations. When the new owners came in, they worked in their laboratories and created versions of humans with a different DNA, the two-stranded, double helix DNA. They took the original DNA of the human species and disassembled it. The original DNA pattern was left within the human cells, yet it was not functional. It was split apart, unplugged. Anything that was unnecessary for survival and that would keep you informed was unplugged, leaving you with only a double helix that would lock you into controllable, operable frequencies. A frequency fence, something like an electrical fence, was put around the planet to control how much the frequencies of humans could be modulated and changed. As the story goes, this frequency fence made it very difficult for the frequencies of light information to penetrate. When light frequencies were able to penetrate the control fence, there was no light to receive them. The human's DNA was unplugged, the light-encoded filaments were no longer organized, so the creative cosmic rays that brought light did not have anything to plug into and hold on to. Already in the beginning of the devastating space war, the Earth Lyrans, still living in the Scandinavian area, left the planet after there had been some nuclear detonations, and some of the living library had been destroyed in the process. The Earth Lyrans were lost for quite a while before they finally found their new home in the Pleiades. On a planet which orbited one of the older stars in the constellation, they found a planet which was beautiful and not too much unlike Earth. This became their new home, and this Lyran group is the one we normally connect with the PL. Iadians, and they are our cousins, because they share our DNA. As time went by, other Lyran groups migrated to the Pleiades as well and colonized other planets, so the star system contains both Earth Lyrans and those who are pure Lyrans, some of them having no connection with Earth, and never did. At a later time, when the Anunnaki were highly involved in genetic engineering of mankind, some of the Pleiadians returned to Earth in hope to be able to again live on the planet they loved so much in the past. This turned out to be a bad decision. Many of them got caught up with the Anunnaki experiments and joined them and their culture of war, drama, sexual promiscuity, including incest, and jealousy. These Lyrans, Pleiadians therefore also became part of the Atlantis drama. This is where their karma comes from, and to free themselves from their Atlantic karma, in which we humans, as mass consciousness, are part as well, they need us to avoid repeating the same mistakes they made in the highly technological Atlantis, as time now is repeating itself. We are beginning to make the same mistakes the gods were making 11,500 years ago. According to the Pleiadians, and it's easy to see that they are correct, we are currently, here in the United States, living in the new Atlantis that has been planned for hundreds of years behind the scenes. Sir Francis Bacon was just being one of the planners. Both the Rosicrucian Order and Freemasonry are promoting a new Atlantean future for mankind, and other secret orders are doing the same, in their own ways. I am going to tell you the story of the Anunnaki and their involvement in creating Homo sapiens sapiens in the next few papers in great details, but it's mostly told from Sitchin's perspective. Although I put a lot of faith in Sitchin's research, it is not telling the whole story, and some of it has been intentionally altered, although not necessarily by Sitchin, but by the Anunnaki. Therefore, I want to give a short, slightly different summary of their part of history in this paper as well, as I firmly believe there is much more to the story than that which is told in the Sumerian scriptures. In the second level of learning, I will elaborate much more on this subject. The general concept is that the Anunnaki took an existing species, which we today call Homo erectus, and upgraded them by using Anunnaki DNA, but I do not support that version of our history. From what I have concluded, Homo erectus has very little, if anything, to do with present Homo sapiens sapiens. It's a totally different species, not having more in common with us than perhaps the gorilla or the chimpanzee. Even if the Anunnaki used Homo erectus and experimented with them as well, they must have abandoned that path in favor of the much more highly evolved humans. At one point in time, probably already when they were at war with the original planners of the Living Library, the Lyrans, the Anunnaki started working together with both the Dracos and the Orion reptilians, or they may already have had this liaison before the Anunnaki came to Earth. This united team could successfully chase off the Lyrans, and the Lyran faction that was to become the Pleiadians, from our planet. Left here was an incomplete Living Library, now in the hands of the Anunnaki. Sitchin's story is going to be told in the next few papers, but metaphysical sources, like the Guardians, and especially the Pleiadians, whom I have no reason to believe is deceiving us at all on this matter, are telling us something quite different than Sitchin. I have listened to the Pleiadians quite a lot and been careful to get a feel for them, and I have never had any reasons whatsoever to doubt their intentions and their information. Sitchin, on the other hand, did the translation of the Sumerian cuneiform text, written about 5,000 to 6,000 years ago, and I believe the translations being accurate, and much of what Sitchin revealed is true, but the Anunnaki, whom to a large degree dictated what is written in them, whether directly or by verbally telling the history of humankind to the Sumerians, had all the reasons to withhold crucial information and sometimes even blatantly lie to cover up the real history of the original creator gods, who we, the human beings, really are, and where we come from. Homo sapiens sapiens, the modern human, was a tremendous downgrade from the original 12-strand multidimensional human. The Anunnaki are still working together with the reptilians, and it also looks like they are, still, using factions of the Greys as their servants as well. 6. Etr. The stories are in the rocks. Before we start talking about the Greys, here is an interesting side note, giving us perhaps a clue of how some of the species who visited Earth in ancient times looked like. An old friend of mine of Native Indian descendant, Barbara Brown aka Wyolawa, or Wyo for short, who is also the owner of WyolawaPress.com, posted a picture on her website about 12 years ago. It's a rock formation which can be found in the Superstition Mountains in Arizona. At a first glance, that's what it is, a rock formation. However, if you look carefully, you can see how faces and figures were carved out of the rock, almost like in an impressionistic painting by Claude Monet. Wyolawa claims this is the art of the old gods, depicting them as they really looked like, hidden in plain sight, and only for those with eyes to see. The interesting thing with this formation is that the amount of faces and whole body figures, creatures you can see in this picture fluctuates depending on your day-to-day awareness level. Look at it closely, download it if you want and blow it up, study it and come back to it another day. More features will most probably pop up. 12 years ago, when I first saw it, I could only isolate a few creatures, but today I can see a vast amount and they are pretty obvious. A mind-blowing and curious exercise. 7. The Zeta Reticulians, aka the Greys. I have saved this subsection until last because it's complex and needs extra attention. Ever since Whitley Strieber wrote about his encounters with the Greys decades ago, this species has popped up ever so often in the UFO literature, often described as a malevolent race, doing genetic experiments on humans without their consent. They have quite a bad reputation. Now, when we better understand who they are, we can also see that these beings have been part of Earth's mythology for hundreds of years. So let us take a look at this species a little closer and more objective than what is the norm. The original home planet of the Zeta Reticuli Grays was called Apex and was located in the Lyrant star system. On Apex, a nuclear war destroyed most of its surface, and the inhabitants had to live underground for thousands of years. Due to radiation, their reproductive capacities were damaged so that cloning was the only way for the species to survive. Their bodies mutated and became those we now know as the Zeta Reticuli Grays. Before the nuclear war, the Apexians had already ecological problems. Just like we do here on Earth, they used negative energy, electrogravity, for selfish purposes, and polluted their planet. Then, on top of that, they were invaded and infiltrated by an alien race called the Verdants, originating from another galaxy some 14 million light-years from here. This invasion culminated in the nuclear war, and a faction of the Greys were captured and made into foot soldiers for the Verdants. The Verdant themselves were already then a very advanced race, reptilian in nature, looking a little bit like the Greys we are used to see. Apex, in the beginning, looked quite similar to Earth. It was a beautiful planet with lots of resources. Just like we humans, the inhabitants of Apex were a mix of different races due to that the early Lyrans had already started colonizing Sector 9. Apex, like so many other planets, was used for genetic engineering by these different creator god species from within the Lyran constellation. Hence, the inhabitants had also a generous mix of ideologies. Some worshipped technology, others rejected it, some were warriors while others were peace bringers, and so on. However, due to a wide variety of ideologies, the gap between those who were choosing the path of technology and those who were more spiritual, or closer to nature, became bigger and bigger. Leading groups on the planet started using technology very destructively, just like we are beginning to do here on Earth. And the history of Apex could be a great study project for us here on this planet to learn what could be our destiny if we don't change our ways. They started polluting the planet without thinking the least about the consequences, and also began to use nuclear power destructively, exactly like we are doing as a human species. In addition, they have told humans that at least part of the reason why their planet became inhabitable was because of their overuse of electrogravity. However, there were those who were smarter and could see what was coming, so they started building underground facilities and shelters in case of a catastrophe, which they could foresee based on the direction in which things were going. According to Lisa Royal and her channeled messages from Germain, the Apexians did not realize, or simply just ignored the facts, that their nuclear experiments and misuse of technology had started breaking down the planetary energy field on a subquantum, subatomic level. This created an electromagnetic warp in the time-space fabric surrounding the planet. While the species were living underground, Apex changed its position in the time-space continuum because of the dramatic subquantum energy breakdown. Germain, Collective, through Lisa Royal, continues. Time and space is very much like Swiss cheese. A planet in one location is connected through a series of multidimensional networks or passageways to other areas of your galaxy. When this warp began around their planet, the planet was moved through the fabric of time, space to another time, space continuum, which was a significant distance from their point of origin. You have labeled this area the Reticulum Star Group. The Apex planet was inserted in the Reticulum system around one of the faintest stars in that star group. This occurred simply because the planetary shift followed the fabric of time and space. The underground Apexians were totally unaware of this as they continued with their lives under the surface. They continued saving their species. Germain explains further that while the Apexians were living underground, without natural sunlight, they worked on restructuring their genetic setup so their bodies could more easily adapt to the new, inconvenient situation. So with time they developed larger eyes with pupils that covered the whole cornea of the eyes, so they could absorb light on other frequencies to keep their bodies and minds functioning. They lost their reproduction organs due to that they didn't give natural birth anymore. They also lost their digestive tract atrophied, because they were no longer eating solid food. Instead, they learned how to absorb nutrients through their skin. Because the nuclear disaster affected everybody on the planet, all kinds of diversity was going on underground, too. They seemed to have one thing in common, though. After had pondered their new situation, they came to the conclusion that the reason for the catastrophe was the species' emotional side. Therefore, they agreed to take out the emotional part from their biogund, biomind, and thus became quite emotionless. To avoid a similar disastrous situation in the future, they started creating a neurochemical structure in which an outside stimulus would create the same reaction in all of them. This way, they felt they could integrate into one people and not let passion and emotions rule them into a downward spiral. Although they had now turned much into what we call a beehive community, there were still different philosophies playing their part in their culture. Each faction had their own viewpoint on whom they were on a higher level of existence. Some of them became more benevolent than others, in our terms of thinking, although it was all about different viewpoints on how to best survive. As mentioned earlier, Apex was a big center for genetic engineering, and lots of experiments with different ET races were taking place there long before the nuclear war, making the surface uninhabitable. The Apexians, who eventually turned into the Short Greys, were, according to the Germain group, originally of a vegan humanoid biokind, and the mutations that happened due to the nuclear disaster is what changed their body type. On the other hand, they are talking about a second, not so humanoid looking kind of vegans, who are more reptilian or insect like in appearance, but still humanoid, mammals, with a copper base in skin and bloodstream which also give them a slight greenish color. These would probably be the reptilian-humanoid hybrids the vegans created while on Earth during the dinosaur era, as discussed above. The Greys could very well have those genes mixed in as well. Genetic engineering is the game of the gods, and it is extremely common throughout the universe, even to the point that it seems to be a part of the evolutionary progress of a species to eventually become like the gods and start manipulating DNA to improve their own species. And as they get more advanced, while traveling through space, time, they also want to create new species on other worlds by either manipulating the DNA of creatures already living there, or create life on whole new worlds. Humans have already begun this process in secret laboratories and in huge facilities underground, such as the infamous Area 51 in Nevada. The creator gods are rarely making perfect products in their first attempts, and before they are satisfied, lots of beings of lesser perfection are created. Mostly, these failures are destroyed, but it depends on the creator gods. Sometimes they don't bother, and just leave the imperfect prototypes to their destiny. The former Apexians, today's Zeta Reticulians, are not the only types of Greys out there. In fact, several sources point out that the Grey Sauroid, reptilian type is not uncommon at all in the universe, even in other galaxies. However, the types of Short Greys that have interfered with us on Earth, or have been sighted the most, are often the ones from the Zeta Reticuli 1 and 2 star systems, whose ancestors were the Apexians. Today, here on Earth, we have a quite misleading stereotype vision of who the Greys are, assuming they are all quite negative in nature. This is a common error we make. We have a tendency to categorize alien species to fit into one box or the other, bad aliens and good aliens. I've pointed this out before, but we'll do it again because of its importance. We need to stop categorizing ET races in the above manner. It is very misleading. It is true that we humans have had some very disturbing experiences with the Greys, but this is only from certain groups of them. Not all of them are like that. This goes for other races as well. No race is purely evil or purely good. There are all shades of gray in between, no pun intended. With that said, let's continue with the story. There is a faction of the Greys that for one has more Lyran genes in them, which means they are more warrior-like and are striving to gain power. Another faction is more spiritual in general and don't interfere with us in a negative way, if at all. Some of them can even be very loving, although some of these Greys are almost certainly from elsewhere, aside from Zeta Reticuli. There are also other former apex greys who have a slightly different body structure than the one we are most familiar with. So, even if many of the greys we have learned about here on Earth may act and look different from each other, many of them have the same origins. After many generations, the underground greys considered it relatively safe to return to the surface of the planet again. They were quite shocked when they noticed a totally different sky scenario. The stars looked very different from what they were used to, the constellations were different, and also, it was not the same sun. It slowly sank into their minds that their planet was no longer in the same solar system as before they went underground. They had no clue where they were, and it took them quite some time to figure out that their new home was now in the Zeta Reticuli system. Due to what had happened with Apex traveling through a wormhole, the Greys learned about folding space and how to use wormholes, stargates, and black holes for space travel. This new reality also brought their different factions together in attempts to understand their situation, and they were united in spirit, at least for a while. Even though they had lived underground for many generations, the species had kept their technological knowledge intact, and they still knew how to space travel. They started building spaceships again and began to explore their new star system and populated some of the planets around Zeta Reticuli 1 and 2. Eventually, a more self-serving group broke out and left the star system to explore other worlds in other parts of the universe. Some of them ended up in the Orion system, while others went to the Sirius Trinary system. Some who have experienced abductions by the Greys, and channelers and researchers say, that a faction of the Greys from Zeta Reticuli are working together with the reptilians from Orion and once became their inferior, or foot soldiers. Others, like author, contactee, and researcher George Lobuono on the other hand, are convinced the main faction of the robotic Greys work with the Verdants, a distant race who is here on a not-so-benevolent mission. Personally, I think it's a mix of both, and more. It could also very well be that the Greys that have appeared during abductions where the Anunnaki are the main abductors could have been there because they have a treaty with the Orion reptilians, whom in their turn work with the Anunnaki. This means that the Greys may not work directly with the Nibiruans, but have been present because of the Orions. The Greys, at one point in time, started to evolve and explore space, and like many newly evolved species, they experimented with electrogravity, which brought the attention to many other galactic and intergalactic species due to the potential danger in doing so. Used in an inappropriate way, electrogravity may not only lessen the longevity of the Sun and its solar system, but the galaxy and the universe as a whole. Of course, this draws attention from many concerned races who are much more advanced and have a full grasp of this problem with young civilizations. It's like parents who left their young adolescents alone and now have to correct them. The Apexian Greys, using electrogravity negatively, like we humans are now, were at the same time spotted by the Verdants, who are an intergalactic conquering race, very much like the Lyrans used to be, but are expanding their empire outside their own galaxy. The Verdants infiltrated the Apexian government, and the interaction between the two cultures eventually led to the destruction of Apex, according to Lobuono. It's unclear to me when the following happened, but either when the Apexians were still living on Apex, or when their planet had moved to Zeta Reticuli, the Verdants started abducting them in large quantities and conducted genetic experiments on them, making them less emotional to be used as their front soldiers, while the Verdants themselves were hiding behind them in the background, making the Greys scapegoats for further manipulation of races and genetic engineering of new species, similar to that which we see today here on Earth. The Orion reptilians are millions, and the Verdants probably billions of years ahead of us in the evolution. They know how to put up screen memories to manipulate the abductees, including using soul traps, which makes it nearly impossible to penetrate the real memories behind the memory shield. Hence, the Verdants, for example, when abducting people, can implant false memories, blaming reptilians for the abduction, and vice versa. I think this happens a lot. We tend to forget about those things, having some kind of delusive conception, not realizing how far ahead of us these races are. Humanity, in comparison, are small children who are just learning to crawl. Still, we think we understand what ETs can and can't do. George Lobuono, in his excellent book, Alien Mind, at least gives us a clue. One thing most researchers, including myself, are quite certain about is that the Greys can no longer mass produce, and they even seem to lack sex organs, and instead use cloning to expand the number of individuals. Some of them, probably, also lack souls. In other words, they are onto cybernetic. Others believe that the Greys are time travelers, and thus are us in the future, coming back to their own past, perhaps just like the Pleiadians, trying to change us, so we can change the timeline which led to the society these species live within in the future. One thing does not exclude the other, though. We are creating different timelines continuously with our thoughts and emotions, and on one of them we may have let the Verdants and the Greys succeed with completely, or nearly completely, manipulate our DNA/RNA to such a degree that we become like them. A similar thing may have happened in terms of the Pleiadians. Both these species may therefore have come back to our time, trying to change their own present, our future. But why now? It is because of the nanosecond, the term coined by the Pleiadians. See other papers for more complete definition of this term. The nanosecond is when timelines merge, partly due to our alignment with the galactic center which changes our DNA, and many of us become truly and consciously multidimensional. The second meaning is that of the word nanosecond itself. Nano means extremely small, or 1/10^9. A nanosecond in that sense would mean a billionth of a second, referring to the time frame of 1987 to 2012 in relation to the age of the universe. In other words, these 25 years is like a nanosecond in the cycle of the universe. On the other hand, the Pleiadians are talking about the machine kingdom, based on nanotechnology, and there we have the word nano again. This is the big challenge we have in front of us. Are we going to stop relying so much on technology and start trusting our internet, or are we going to let nanotechnology take us to places where most of us don't want to go, which includes cloning of humans, genetic manipulation of our species, in combination with negative use of electrogravity, creation of androids, making humans into onto cybernetics, robots, machines, and in the process we lose our souls and our sexual ability to mass produce. Today, many people are laughing at such a science fiction-like future, but it is very real and it is already starting to happen rapidly. I have posted quite a few articles on my blog, News from Behind the Scenes, battleofaearth.wordpress.com, on this subject. And these articles are not part of some weird conspiracy theory, they are posted in highly scientific papers and websites, or in mainstream media. The Pleiadians are very clear with that they are here to help us make a rational decision for our future. By informing us about our choices, enough of us will make decisions which will not lead into an irreversible trap. We don't want to end up like the Greys. At this point in time, the Greys can be seen as catalysts for us humans. If we do what they did, we end up like them. If we avoid the traps they stepped into as a younger species, we may survive. Sober as that. The reasons listed by us humans as of why some Greys are abducting humans is long. We have already mentioned one plausible reason, genetic manipulation to make our species non-sexual like them. This is something we will discuss more in depth in a later paper about the Verdants and the Greys, but this is definitely happening. Others say that the Greys want to be able to reproduce like us instead of having to clone themselves. Just like when you make copies of a copy on the copy machine, and continually make copies out of these copies, eventually the quality will decrease until it's unreadable. It's the same with cloning, the bodies will degenerate after so many cloning attempts. The bodies will not be good enough to carry a soul, and eventually cloning won't work at all anymore. Some say this is where the Greys are at now, and the reason they abduct humans is to collect their DNA and even let human women carry their fetuses, in hope to be able to create a body type strong enough to be a soul carrier. Again, Both options could be correct, depending on which faction of the Greys we are dealing with at a particular time. Those who work for the Verdants may have their agenda, while others, who are free from Verdant influence, may try to find a way back to their old lives as a sexually reproducing species. All in all, I think many Greys have received a bad, undeserved reputation. With that said, I don't mean we should go out and mingle with all the Greys we may see, but just as an observation after have studied the subject. I also think they have been ruthlessly used and taken advantage of to become slave species for other ET groups. Like I mentioned briefly above, there are those who have seen them together with the Anunnaki as well. Which brings us right to the subject of the next paper.